These are the words that our Heavenly Mother directed to her earthly children on the night of January the 17th, 1871, the day when Paul Hamlet in Western France, during the Franco-Prussian War. It was through her intercession and because of the prayers of her children that the war suddenly came to an end that very night. We now undertake the pleasant task of retelling the inspiring story of Our Lady of Fontmain, because we are convinced that all the heavenly visitations of the Mother of God offer to us a divine message that is given to us for the good of our souls. We do not wish to show ourselves indifferent and ungrateful to the manifestations of divine mercy and goodness that are always so evident in all the apparitions of which God is the author. We do not want to turn a deaf ear to God's special revelations given to us through our Blessed Lady, and which have been so outstanding, especially during the past 140 years. In 1971, the centenary or 100th anniversary of Our Lady's unusual apparition at Fontmain was duly noted, not only in France, but elsewhere also. Here in the United States, there was at least some publicity given to it, though Our Lady of Fontmain deserved far more publicity than what she actually received. Thus, for example, there was an article entitled "The War That Suddenly Ended" in the January 1971 issue of Immaculata magazine, published by the Conventual Franciscan Friars of Marytown in Kenosha, Wisconsin. This interesting article of 4 pages, which told the story of Our Lady of Fontmain in brief form, was accompanied by large and clear pictures showing the shrine of Fontmain as it is today. Another example of most welcome publicity given to Our Lady of Fontmain during her centenary year was a 78-page pamphlet entitled "What Happened at Fontmain," published by the Ave Maria Institute of Washington, New Jersey, which is the headquarters for the Blue Army of Our Lady of Fatima. The important thing about this pamphlet is that it reproduces, in English, the story of Fontmain as it was written by a French priest, Father M. Richard, shortly after the apparition of January the 17th, 1871, took place. Father Richard came to Fontmain personally in order to question the 4 children who saw Our Lady, as well as the villagers who were present during the apparition, so they did not see Our Lady. After all these interviews, Father Richard went home and wrote the story of the apparition. And it has been said that he did this on his knees, out of reverence for God's work at Fontmain. But he did not publish the booklet until after he had made a second visit to Fontmain, so as to have his story of the apparition checked by the visionaries and the other witnesses. He read his account of the apparition to them and asked them to make any necessary corrections right on the spot, because he wanted to publish an accurate account, as accurate an account of the apparition as was possible. The booklet was then published on March the 1st, 1871. Father Richard was a chaplain for the Sisters of Hope, as their congregation is called, in the city of Laval, which is some 180 miles or so to the southwest of Paris, and about 30 miles southeast of the village of Fontmain. Laval, with some 30,000 population today, was the episcopal city of that area. Fontmain belonged to the Diocese of Laval. aside from the Immacolata magazine article and the American edition of Father Richard's story of Fontaine, there have long existed several books that treat of a number of Marian apparitions in modern times, and include the story of Our Lady of Fontaine. Thus, for example, we have the full-length book entitled Mary versus Lucifer, written by Father John Ireland Gallery of Chicago in 1960, which devotes 8 pages to Our Lady of Fontaine. And then we can also mention the work entitled Famous Shrines of Our Lady in 2 volumes by Mr. Henry Gillette, published in 1950. The first volume of this work gives 11 pages to Our Lady of Fontaine. Though there are other sources besides these, the ones we have mentioned are the more important ones and perhaps the more easily available. Our purpose in retelling the story of Our Lady of Fontaine now is not merely a belated observance of the centenary, but rather it is the importance of the divine message of Fontaine, which simply should not be forgotten. Here we have the everlasting story of God's mercy and goodness, to which we have already referred. It is the everlasting story of the solicitude of the spiritual mother of men for her earthly children, and another of the never-ending proofs of the power of her intercession with God. It is another invitation from her to seek her aid and maternal protection in times of need, but with the understanding that we must be faithful to her divine Son and to her at all times, whether these be good or bad. In fact, the key to understanding the reason why Our Lady chose the tiny hamlet of Fontaine for her special favors, from which all France benefited, lies precisely in the fact that the faithful living there were devoted to her divine Son and to her. On the whole, they were truly devout and faithful in living up to their holy Catholic faith. A true Catholic atmosphere prevailed in the parish of Fontaine, which is said to have comprised around 500 souls at that time, and a total of about 80 families. The credit for developing a truly Catholic spirit among the parishioners of Fontaine has rightly been given to the parish priest, Abbé Michel Guérin, or Father Michael Guérin. For 35 years before the apparition of 1871, Father Guérin labored zealously for the souls entrusted to his care, and as Father Richard writes, his efforts were blessed with a people deeply Christian. And then Father Richard adds, one never sees work on Sundays in Fontaine. It is indeed rare ever to hear the Lord's name taken in vain. Children raised in the fear of God respect and obey their parents. But more than this can be told of Father Guérin. He was deeply devoted to the Blessed Mother, and he succeeded in instilling this love of Mary into the souls of his people. One of the important things that he did was to establish the Archconfraternity of the Immaculate Heart of Mary in his parish. An Archconfraternity fraternity that had been originally founded in Paris in 1836. And in addition to this, he also made the total consecration of St. Louis de Montfort to Mary, which is in reality a total consecration to Jesus through Mary. Not only did he consecrate himself in this way, but he succeeded in eventually having all his parishioners make the same total consecration to Jesus through Mary. He gave them a thorough preparation for the total consecration by instructing them in St. Louis de Montfort's true devotion to Mary on Sunday evenings. One of the external manifestations of total consecration to Mary was the fact that every home in the little Pontmain parish had at least two statues of Our Lady, one over the front door and the other over the fireplace. Father Guerin died in the odor of sanctity in 1872, the year after the Pontmain apparition of Our Lady. And the cause of his beatification was introduced eventually, though we are not able to say what the status of his cause is right now. Before we take up the story of the apparition itself, we have good reason to mention that the name of Mary is the family name of the mother of St. Therese of Lisieux, the little flower, who was born in somewhat the same general area of France as the location of the apparition, though not right close to it in terms of miles, maybe some 75 miles away or so. However, a good reason for bringing in her name now, that is St. Therese, is the fact that she was born 100 years ago last Tuesday, that is, on January the 2nd, 1873. To locate Pontmain a little more precisely, we can say that it is hidden away, as one writer put it, in the far northwest corner of a district called Mayenne, which we would call a county in this country. And Mayenne is part of the province of Brittany that takes in that part of France that projects far out into the Atlantic Ocean below England. Normandy is just to the north of Brittany and is all too well remembered for the invasion of the Allied forces in World War II. But to us, it is still better remembered for Lisieux, made famous by St. Therese. And now we go back to January the 17th, 1871. The Franco-Prussian War was in progress. That is, the war of 1869 to 1871 between France and Bismarck, Germany, which was so often referred to as Prussia in times past, even though Prussia is actually only part of Germany. France was being very badly beaten by the Prussians, who had taken Paris and were well on their way towards the Atlantic coast, far to the southwest of Paris. The war was practically won and finished as far as the Prussians were concerned. In reality, it was about finished. But it was not won by them, the Prussians. A divine intervention was about to take place. And history indicates that the Prussians never really knew what happened to keep them from winning the war. In the week that preceded the Pompeian apparition, the Prussians won a great battle at Mans, M-A-N-S, or Le Mans, which is about 50 miles to the east of Laval. Then they pushed quickly to the west towards Laval, and stopped about a mile from it on January the 17th, 1871. The German commander named General Schmidt boasted that morning, "Tonight my troops enter Laval," which was, as we have already said, the headquarters of the Bishop of Laval. Pompeian, 30 miles to the northwest of Laval and near the Brittany-Normandy border, also lay in the path of the enemy, which is said to have been ruthless in destroying and burning and stealing. In the afternoon of January the 17th, Father Guerin summoned his parishioners to church for fervent prayer to Our Lady. Though the enemy was closer to Laval, the people of Pompeii never knew how soon the right flank of the invaders might overrun their village. It was a Tuesday. After the public prayers were completed, Father Guerin remained kneeling in silent prayer for a few minutes, and then he got up and turned to the people and spoke to them these words: "Trust in our Blessed Mother. Remember, we are consecrated to her as her possession and property. She is with us. She will take care of us. Place all your trust in her immaculate heart." This expression of devotion to the Immaculate Heart of Mary was long before that devotion came into its own after Our Lady's apparition to Fatima in 1917. And the feast in honor of the Heart of Mary in those days was not called the Feast of the Immaculate Heart, but the Feast of the Most Pure Heart of Mary. The Barbadet family, which was present for the Tuesday afternoon emergency devotion, was chosen by Heaven's Queen to receive her message from God to be given that evening. Besides the father and the mother, there were three boys in the family and no girl. The father's first name was Caesar, C-E-S-A-R, same as somebody in California who is notoriously associated with grapes. The mother's name was Victoria. One of the boys was old enough for the army, so he was away at war. But the other two boys were Eugene, age 12, and Joseph, age 10. It is said that their older brother in the army was actually their stepbrother, although we were not able to verify this in the various authors. The two young boys, Eugene and Joseph, slept in the barn, so their father used to come and wake them up. On Tuesday, January the 17th, he woke them up as usual at 6 o'clock in the morning. They, after saying their morning offering, they prepared the feed for the horses first, then went to the house to see the rosary for their brother in the service, and then they went to serve Holy Mass in the church, which was quite close to their home. But while waiting for the pastor, Father Guerin to show up for the Mass, they also prayed the Stations of the Cross for their brother in the war, who was away from home already about 4 months by then. During the day, they attended classes in school. Night had fallen, and the two boys were again in the barn, helping their father with the usual chores, taking care of the livestock, especially preparing the feed for the horses. The evening chores began at about 5:30, and then after about 15 minutes or so, a woman named Jeanette came to the barn to tell Mr. Barbadet that she had seen his son in the army and that he was just fine so far. While she was standing there talking to Mr. Barbadet, Eugene, the 12-year-old boy, stepped outside the big green barn door on the side just to take a look at the weather, as he said later. That big green door had a smaller door in it. Over to his left somewhat, Eugene could see the church, while straight across the way, about 75 steps or so, and practically next to the church, was the house of a neighbor named Augustine Pietro. There was snow on the ground. It was very cold. It had been an unusually cold winter so far, which added to the misery of a losing war. The sky was clear, and the stars seemed to be thicker than usual, especially over the road going past the barn and through the village. But directly ahead and over the Geetko house, the boy saw fewer stars. It was now the providential moment that God had arranged and chosen for an unusual Marian apparition, which we might call a dramatic Marian presentation in the sky. It was approximately 5:45 p.m. Suddenly, Eugene saw a tall and beautiful lady about 20 feet above the Geetko house. The lady's gown was dark blue and was covered with golden stars. It was not in any way gathered in at the waist, but fell straight down to her feet. The sleeves were wide and flowing. The lady wore slippers of the same dark blue color as the gown, and on them were golden rosettes, appearing to be made of golden ribbons, or simply golden bows, you could call them. The lady wore a black veil that completely hid her hair and ears, and that fell behind her shoulders to the middle of her back, just as the veils of our genuine sisters used to do, until so many of them discarded them for handkerchief-like renewal top pieces, while very many have discarded their God-given veils altogether, even for church, where church law requires all women and girls to wear head coverings. Besides her black veil, the lady wore an unusual golden crown on her head. The crown widened out, as many types of crowns do, but there were no points on it, as is so often seen on crowns. The only ornament on the crown was what has been described as a thin red line or thread encircling the crown in about the middle of it. But we have not heard or read of any explanation for that thin red line. The lady was of incomparable beauty, such as we cannot really imagine. She had her hands spread out in the way we so often see Our Lady of Grace or Mary Immaculate. As Eugene Barbadet looked in amazement at the beautiful lady in the sky above the Guito house, she smiled at him. She did that most of the time during the apparition. Eugene wondered whether she might have come to announce the death of his brother, who had not written to his parents for 3 weeks now. But he didn't feel afraid because the lady was smiling. Eugene looked at the heavenly vision all enraptured for about 15 minutes when Jeanette finally came out of the bar. The boy asked her if she could see anything up there in the sky. But she, in great surprise, said she couldn't see anything at all. He was wondering why he asked her. Eugene's father heard the two talking outside the door, so he quickly came out, and Joseph, age 10, came with him. The father saw nothing, but Joseph saw exactly what Eugene saw. He described the lady in the same way. The father, dumbfounded by all this, finally told the boys that they don't see anything and ordered them back into the barn to finish feeding the horses. They obeyed without hesitation. Mr. Barbzett couldn't get his mind off what the boys kindly saw. So after about 10 minutes, he told Eugene to go out and see if the vision was still there. And he found that the beautiful lady was still there, smiling. Mr. Barbadet, who had told Jeanette to keep quiet about all this, finally told Eugene to go to the house and call his mother. When the mother came, she found little Joseph standing by the door of the barn, clapping his hands joyfully and exclaiming, "Oh, how beautiful she is! How beautiful she is!" His mother gave him a blow on the arm and told him to shut up. She herself saw nothing. She was nevertheless impressed by the sincerity of the two boys. And she knew that they never told lies. She had never heard them tell a lie, fearing that maybe they were really seeing the Blessed Virgin. She advised saying five Our Fathers and Hail Marys in honor of the Blessed Mother. But because the neighbors were beginning to notice what was going on and were getting curious, she closed the barn door and they said the prayers inside the barn without being seen. They dreaded the embarrassment that would come if this was all a phony vision. What would people say? That's what worried Mr. and Mrs. Barbadet. After the prayers, the two boys still insisted that they saw a beautiful lady up in the sky. So the mother went to the house to get her glasses and even brought the maid along. She still saw nothing. Glasses didn't help her one bit.
thought she was getting angry. And I suppose we could say that her pride was hurt. And she called the boys a couple of liars. She told them to finish their work in the barn and come to the house for supper. It was about 6:15 when they reluctantly followed their father to the house for supper, but they walked backwards so that they could continue to look at the beautiful lady in the sky. They ate their soup in a hurry and standing, something like the Israelites ready to dash out of Egypt in days of old. Their mother let them go out again to take a look after eating, but she demanded that they again say five Our Fathers and five Hail Marys. Only they were to stand while praying because it was too cold for them to kneel. The boys came back into the house after the prayers and said the beautiful lady was still there and looking the same as before. They also remarked that she was the same size as one of the three sisters at the convent, a sister named Sister Vitaline. This prompted their mother to call the sister, because she figured that the sister was better than the boys and would surely be sufficient too, if they thought. But that is not the way divine logic works. We well know from the various apparitions of the past that we know from our Lord's own words in the Gospel, God so often prefers to choose the little one to be the first recipient of his messages. But the sister, when summoned, did not see the vision, though she did see three bright stars that formed a triangle, which eventually all the people are said to have seen. Eugene said that Our Lady's head was found in the center of the triangle of stars. Sister Vitaline went to the convent to summon two young girls, Frances, aged 11, and Jean Marie, 9 years old, and they both immediately saw the vision and described the lady in the same way as the two Barbadet boys had done. Another sister, Sister Mary Edward, was called to the scene, but she did not see the lady in blue in the sky. And the third sister's name was Victoria, Sister Victoria. She did not see Our Lady. A 6-year-old boy, also named Eugene, saw the lady. But his mother took him back to the house after about 10 minutes because it was so cold. A 2-year-old baby girl, held in her mother's arms, also saw the lady and exclaimed several times, "The Jesus! The Jesus!" But she was also soon taken back to her home because of the cold. Thus, a total of 6 children, they alone, actually saw the lady. But it was only those first four, that saw the entire apparition, or the girls almost the entire apparition. Sister Mary Edward was the one who first thought of calling Father Guerin over to the scene of the vision, strange as that might seem. We might think that somebody would have called him right away. Father Guerin was frightened by the vision. He came just as something new appeared in the vision. The lady suddenly appeared within a large blue frame of an oval shape. And inside this blue frame were four candles, two of them about the height of the lady's shoulders, and the other down about the level of her knees. The candles were on candle holders that were attached to the inside of the blue frame. The appearance of the blue oval frame around the lady, which surrounded her to the end of the vision, began what in French they have called the second phase of the apparition of Our Lady of Fontaine, and which we might simply call the second scene in the divine drama in the sky. Three other scenes were yet to appear, making the whole vision a kind of picture story of five scenes. In the second scene, or second phase, the lady looked the same as before, except that a tiny red cross appeared on her breast. The crowd of people kept getting larger, some of them being skeptical, but most of them inclined to believe the children. There was much praying and also much singing of Marian hymns during the vision, with Sister Mary Edward leading the singing and even leading the rosary. Father Guerin asked everyone to pray, so they all knelt down, despite the snow and cold. Some of them managed to kneel down inside the barn. During the rosary, the lady became twice her size, and the blue oval frame expanded accordingly, as if to indicate that such prayers increase her glory and make her greater in the eyes of men and make her better known and loved. At the same time, the golden stars on her blue dress multiplied, so much so that the children said her dress would soon be nothing but golden stars. The stars outside the blue frame seemed to come two by two and arrange themselves at the lady's feet. And it has been said that there was a total of 40 such stars in Our Lady's feet. During this scene, which was the third and all-important scene in the apparition of Our Lady of Fontaine, a very large white space of shining brightness appeared below the lady and below the blue frame encircling her. It was estimated to have been maybe about 4 feet wide and over 30 feet long, maybe close to 40 feet long. And some have referred to it as a banner or a streamer. But whatever it ought to be called, golden letters, maybe close to a foot high, slowly began to appear on it, as if being written by an invisible hand. The first letter started to appear at the beginning of the singing of the Magnificat, as it was intoned by Sister Mary Edward. And after the first word was written out, it remained there by itself for about 10 minutes. The singing of the Magnificat was interrupted for a while, but by the time it was finished, the first sentence of the lady's message in the sky was completed. It was a plea for prayer. But pray, my children. That is what they have been doing, but they were urged to continue, to persevere in their prayer. It was now probably about 7:30 p.m. Mother Guerin asked for the singing of the Litany of the Blessed Virgin, so that she would, as he said, manifest her will. Sister Mary Edward led the singing, but as soon as the first invocation of the Litany was sung, more writing began to appear in the white space below the lady. By the end of the Litany, the second sentence of the lady's message appeared and read as follows: God will hear you in a short time. The people were overjoyed when they heard this. Our Lady had been smiling all the time. Then a hymn in honor of Mary Immaculate was sung, and immediately some more writings began to appear. The first two sentences were all on the same line: but pray, my children. That's the first sentence, and the second one: God will hear you in a short time. But the third and last sentence of the lady's message was beneath them on another line. As soon as the first two words of that sentence, my son, appeared, the children cried out, it really is the Blessed Virgin. And the crowd was completely overcome with emotion and repeated, it is she, it is she. The lady had now identified herself as the mother of the Son of God. The singing of the hymn continued, and to it the Salve Regina was quickly added. Our Lady lifted her hand to the height of her shoulders as if directing the singing. By the end of the Salve Regina, the invisible hand had written off that last sentence which read, my son permits himself to be moved. This sentence was underlined in gold. The message of Our Lady of Pontmain was now fully written out. And never during the vision did she speak to the children. It was a written message, not a spoken message. Besides, of course, being a picture message, the whole vision was in itself a kind of message, a divine message, written or appearing in the sky. The children jumped up and down with joy, clapped their hands, and kept repeating, oh, how beautiful she is. The people, overcome by it all, both laughed and cried with joy. Our Lady's written message remained visible to the children for about 10 minutes or so. Then an invisible roller, or what seemed like a roller, appeared to come along and erase all the writing. The third scene of Our Lady's picture story was now over. The people now began to sing a hymn to our Lord, saying, forgive our penitent heart. We will no longer offend thy supreme goodness, Lord, sweet Jesus. This hymn was the equivalent of an act of contrition. Our Lady, as if joining the people in this expression of sorrow for sin, took on an expression of great sadness. And she held in her hands a large red crucifix, maybe about 2 feet high, with the two sacred words, Jesus Christ, above it in red lettering on a white background. She held out the crucifix towards the children as if offering it to them. This was scene number 4 in Our Lady's celestial presentation of that night. A star came up from beneath Our Lady's feet and lit the 4 candles in the candle holders attached inside the blue frame encircling the Lady. And then the star went up and rested above her head. Sister Mary Edward began the Ave Maria Stella, or Hail Star of Ocean, and Our Lady began to smile again, and the crucifix disappeared. This was the 5th and last scene. Mother Guerin announced after the singing that night prayer could now be said right there on the spot, and everybody knelt down. The people had been inside the barn for some time because somebody had opened the big green door facing the vision. For a long time, only the little green door inside the big green door, or a part of the big green door, was open. But eventually, they opened the entire door. During the pause for examination of conscience, the children noticed that a great white veil slowly began to move upward from beneath the vision, and little by little, Our Lady disappeared from view, her crown disappearing last. The vision of Our Lady of Fontaine was over. It was about 8:45 p.m., 3 hours after the vision had begun. The people did not know it yet, but at about the very same moment as the vision of Our Lady of Fontaine was ending, the German commander, General Schmidt, just outside Laval, received a totally unexpected order from his supreme headquarters telling him not to enter Laval, as he was just about to do, but to withdraw his troops to 10 miles from the city. 11 days later, an armistice was signed. The war between France and Germany was over, thanks to the powerful intercession of Our Lady and the humble prayers of her children. A little over a year later, on February the 2nd, 1872, and this happened unbelievably fast, as far as a matter like this is concerned, Bishop Weigert of Laval solemnly decreed that the Immaculate Virgin Mary, Mother of God, really appeared on January 17, 1871,